It's Conduit News Radio with Paul Harrell.
Welcome back to the program. We got Michael Bussler is back with us. It's always great to have him on. Dr. Michael Bussler, he's a public policy analyst, economics expert, professor of finance at Stockton University in New Jersey. Michael, how's it going, sir?
It's going very well this morning, Paul. Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. It's always great to have you on. I want to talk about a couple of things. I want to talk about GDP because you were on the program a bunch last year as well as this year talking about, you know, what that's going to be. We've had some positive numbers there. But before, let's talk about maybe the more pressing issue, which is China, the United States. According to the latest report that I saw, looks like the United States went ahead and hiked those tariffs on China like they said they were going to. They tried to get some 11th hour negotiations going, but it didn't seem like those were fruitful. Is that what you're hearing as well?
Yes, that's exactly right. They did negotiate into last night, up till midnight when the deadline was. They couldn't come up with an agreement, so they ended the meeting. The tariffs will go into effect. They are coming back first thing this morning, though, and trying to renegotiate something. You know, this is something that President Trump really doesn't want to do. He doesn't want to put tariffs on really anything. He'd much prefer not to have a long-term agreement where there are no tariffs. The problem is China is not in any hurry to negotiate, and the reason is that the current trade agreements all favor our trading partners and to the detriment of the U.S. For instance, we make a car in here in the U.S. We sell it in Europe, for instance. They put a 10% tariff on. They make a car in Europe, sell it over here. We put only a 2.5% tariff. Same thing with China. They make a car there, sell it in the U.S. We put a 2.5% tariff. They put a 25% tariff on some of our cars. So President Trump wants to get the playing field level. His first goal would be to have no tariffs on anything. But since China is in such a favorable current position, there is no hurry to negotiate. Well, President Trump is not a politician, he's a business person. A business person, when you have a negotiation with a reluctant partner, you want to create a sense of urgency. And that's what he's doing by these tariffs, creating a sense of urgency. They thought they had an agreement a couple of months ago that was really just down to some final details. According to what I'm hearing, China has reneged on some of those agreements. So as a result of that, President Trump, again, wants to create a sense of urgency. And he says, look, if you don't resolve this by Friday, today, I'm going to put heavy tariffs on. You'll notice that quickly brought China to the bargaining table. They sent their vice premier over here yesterday to try to come up with something. They weren't able to do that. But by putting on the tariffs, there will be some short-term pain. But the idea is to create some long-term gain and finally bring China to the table.
And you know what? I think it's kind of a waiting game, you know, if you're just looking at the economic situation. Now, I'm sure the Trump administration wants to keep geopolitical negotiations with North Korea a completely separate issue. But have you heard anybody ask whether or not China is having some influence on North Korea testing these missiles again? Not the ballistic ones, but just these short range ones. Is that maybe them trying to say, hey, you know, maybe, you know, we'll make you look really bad because we've got influence over Kim?
Well, as you mentioned, these are very complicated negotiations, and we're not just dealing with some economic factors. There's geopolitical factors. Usually what business people do is they try to resolve one issue at a time. So I imagine President Trump and his team will concentrate on resolving this trade agreement, and if they can do that, then they'll also start to talk about the North Korea situation, which seems to be escalating since, as you mentioned, North Korea did fire two short-range missiles. Now, the U.S. fired some missiles yesterday also. showing what we can do. We certainly don't want to get into a war, but President Trump has the position, you seek peace through strength. This is something that Ronald Reagan instituted, and it worked extremely well. So President Trump is going to show that we're very strong, and as long as the other nations see how strong we are, they should be very reluctant to do anything militarily. But the idea is, let's get this trade agreement resolved first, and then we'll move on, I think, to these geopolitical events.
I certainly hope so. And I guess I know that China, or at least the word was, is that China was helpful. They wanted, you know, North Korea to no longer be this, this loaded gun that's kind of just pointed at the head of the entire world, you know? And so I know that, but I just kind of thought here, you know, it's at least what we're hearing is that these tariffs are way worse on China than they are on the United States. And they are bad on the United States in some instances. But is it really just a waiting game? We just have to wait for China to come to their senses?
Yeah, and you brought up a very good point. This trade war, which we're in, will hurt China far more than it hurts us. They need us more than we need them. So we put tariffs on their goods like steel. We put a tariff on, Chinese steel becomes expensive. The U.S. then can make their own steel, which is what's our own steel, which is happening now.
And let me just stop you there. That's also a national security thing, too. Like, I would rather we make U.S. steel to build our own military equipment than import anything. I think that's just my opinion, but go ahead, Michael.
I'll tell you, I would agree with you. I'd rather pay a little bit more for the steel, but have the security of knowing we can make our own steel, because if you have to go to war, you need bullets and tanks and things, so you certainly have to have that steel. The China will retaliate. The issue is that China imports from the U.S. food products. And the reason they do that is they don't have the ability, the right climate, to grow all of their own food, especially for the 1.2 billion people. So if China starts putting tariffs on food, which is what they're going to do, that will drive up the cost of food, and there won't be as much food to go around in China. That's going to create a lot of problems for them, too. And I think the Trump administration realizes that, and as a result, the Trump administration is willing to accept some short-term pain, and there will be some short-term pain. Agricultural sectors will suffer a little bit, and some other products will suffer. Americans may pay a little bit more for some things, although a lot of the tariffs are not resulting in price increases. So China is actually paying some of the tariff that's not being passed on to consumers. So President Trump is willing to deal with whatever short-term pain we have to deal with to get a long-term agreement where these markets, China market, is now open freely to American manufacturers, both in the agricultural sector and other sectors. The other key point is China does not recognize intellectual property rights. Mm-hmm. In other words, if somebody in the U.S. comes up with a new design for something or a new formula for something, they get a patent on it. And the patent says, look, we recognize you've invested a lot of money to bring a product to the market. We're going to help ensure that that's at least profitable for you so the product can stay there. So for 17 years, nobody else is allowed to make that product. Now, China, India is like this too, they don't honor those intellectual property rights. So they'll get the product, they'll take it apart, figure out how to make it, and start producing a product over there. Mm-hmm. And that ends up clobbering U.S. manufacturers. So Trump wants an agreement where China will, and this is really the sticking point in the negotiations, where China will recognize their intellectual property rights and stop copying things that they're not supposed to be copying.
Yep, that is going to be a sticking point because, I mean, this, you know, you always eventually get these knockoffs, you know, and in some cases you get them, you get the knockoffs and they lie and they put the original brand back on. And, you know, there are manufacturers that have discovered this over and over again. Like, they go out to service a machine of some kind, and they're like, well, we didn't build this. This didn't actually come from us. It has our logo on it, but not ours.
Right.
So we're talking with Michael Bussler. And let me ask you this. You know, you're on Conduit News here. We're on several stations across Arkansas, broadcasting online as well. We got a lot of soybean farmers here in Arkansas. So what would you say to them? Because, you know, some people have said, hey, look, we're willing to kind of suffer a little bit in the short term here in order to kind of reclaim United States sovereignty in a way.
Yes.
What would you say to Arkansas soybean farmers?
Well, President Trump did allocate some funding for, this was done last year, for agricultural farmers who would be hurt by this. What we would say to them is, look, I know this is going to hurt you, but it will be only short term. China does need our food more than we need whatever products they're making. So I know it's tough, and it's going to hurt a little bit, but if you can absorb the short-term pain, we should be able to come up with an agreement that for the forever, these markets will now be open to you freely, and the short-term pain that you're feeling now should be more than offset by the long-term gain that should come out of these negotiations.
And I would also add to that, Michael, that the farmers who have that mentality are patriots, because there's a real imbalance out there, and President Trump's trying to fix something that's been put off for decades by politicians that claim to be for the common man, but they're really not. We're talking with Michael Bussler. Okay, let's talk about, last year, you know, you and I talked, and there was all these articles about how the economy's not going to, you know, be, it's not, we're not going to get to 3%. And you know, I know we had you on, you said, hey, this some point this year, 4% might even be possible. And then, you know, you just have all of these naysayers, and yet job growth is through the roof, and we get the news, I guess this is April 26th. That U.S. GDP grows by 3.2% in the first quarter. And I know, Dr. Michael Bussler, this wasn't a surprise to you, but it was to a lot of people.
Yeah. I think the people that are forecasting have a little bit of bias in that they don't like President Trump and they don't want to see him succeed, even though if he succeeds, of course, the whole country succeeds. What President Trump did was he put through a tax cut modeled after the tax cut that Reagan did in 1981 and somewhat similar to what Kennedy and Johnson did back in 63. So they lowered taxes for all income earners. That meant for the middle class, you had more, they had more money to spend. That increases demand in the economy and should lead to more growth. They also cut taxes for higher income earners and corporations. Why is that important? Higher income individuals and corporations, after taxes, the income that they have goes into capital. They end up investing it. So not only can will demand pick up in the economy from the middle class, but now businesses will be able to expand supply to meet the new demand because they have capital, new capital. We have a capital-intensive economy, which means most of the things we make today are not made by hand like they used to be, but rather made by robots and artificial intelligence and machinery. So we need capital in order to be able to expand. This tax cut created demand for the middle by the middle class and created an increase in supply by cutting taxes for the upper classes. It will lead to more economic growth. When Reagan did it in 81, it went into effect in 82, coming right out of a very severe recession ending in 81. The tax cut goes into effect in 82. In 1984, GDP grew at 7.5% for the year. Now, I don't think we'll get to that, but I still see stronger economic growth. And if everybody would stop, or not everybody, but if a large number of people would stop fighting President Trump and work with him a little bit, we'd be able to see even higher growth. I'm forecasting this year to have economic growth better than we did last year. And last year was the first year since 2005 that economic growth was at least 3%. From 2005 to 2017, we averaged just over 2% annual growth, and it led to a lot of problems. And last year, we had growth of about 3%. I think as business investment starts to kick in and the economy starts to grow, we're already seeing new jobs being created, record low unemployment numbers. It's to the point today, anybody who really wants to get a job should be able to find one. Since last July, there are more job openings than there are unemployed people.
Wow.
So there are opportunities there. As this all filters through the economy, I see this year economic growth exceeding what we did last year, and that should go a few years into the future. Some economists were talking recession this year. I think there's virtually extremely low chance, almost no chance of that happening. I don't see a recession coming for at least 3 or 4 years down the road.
Yeah, you know, and again, I would say the first quarter was 3.2. I heard, correct me if I'm wrong, but traditionally, isn't that first quarter the worst of the other of the four?
Yeah, the first quarter is, and if you look back in the last 5 or 6 years, the first quarter was always the lowest. Even last year, the first quarter was only in the 2% range. The second quarter was 4.5%. Now, I don't know, second quarter is typically a very good one, as is the third quarter. So we could see numbers for the second quarter, probably, you know, we have a shot to hit that 4% range again. The consensus view is that we'll only be in the 2% range. But again, I think the economy is doing better than that. And I think we could see a 4% number in just the current quarter.
Last question. Next year, we have the presidential election. Do you think there's a possibility, because I don't believe the Fed is a non-political organization. Do you think they could put their thumb on the scale to try to, you know, make the economy worse so President Trump has a harder time getting reelected?
You know, I might have said yes 6 months ago, but there's been so much pressure put on the Fed now to stop raising interest rates so fast. That I don't think they're going to be able to do that. Remember, in 2018, we had just about 3% annual growth. The Federal Reserve raised interest rates four times in 2018. Had they not done that, we might have had even higher. We definitely, I think, would have had even higher growth. So I don't think the Federal Reserve is going to raise interest rates at all this year or even into next year. Now, what might change that? Well, they'll raise interest rates if inflation starts to become a problem. I don't see that happening either for two reasons. One, there's a fear when wages are increasing at over a 3% rate, which is good for workers, wages are going up. The problem is the Federal Reserve notes if wages go up, labor costs are going to go up, and that could be inflationary. Well, if you take a look at productivity, productivity in the first quarter of this year increased by 3.6%. So if your labor costs go up by 3.2, but they're making 3.6 more things, the cost per unit doesn't go up at all. So there's no pressure from wages as long as productivity stays high. And because we have capital to invest, I think that will happen. As long as productivity stays high, wage increases will not cause inflation. Secondly, as I mentioned before, this tax cut was geared not just to increase demand, but economists would say this was also a supply-side tax cut. So if demand starts heating up, it's only a problem if business doesn't have the ability to increase output to meet the demand. If they can't meet the demand by increasing output, then they're going to have to raise prices. But in this case, because of the tax cut creating capital, they should be able to meet the new demand by increasing supply that increases economic growth without any inflationary pressure. So because I don't see any inflationary pressure and the political climate is such that I don't think the Federal Reserve will raise interest rates, I don't see them raising interest rates at all before the election.
Dr. Michael Bussler, it's always great to have you on. I appreciate your analysis. It's very enlightening, and you know, I love the specifics too, because you know, a lot of times you don't get that, but really encouraging. I really appreciate your mind, sir.
Thank you, Paul. It's my pleasure to be here. I look forward to talking to you again.
Absolutely. Yes, sir. It's Dr. Michael Bussler, everybody, public policy analyst from Stockton University in New Jersey. You can go to Newsmax, LifeSet, Town Hall, and you can check out articles that have been written by him that are posted on those sites.